NetBSD is a heavyweight, especially for an early 90s Macintosh. But transferring 200 megabytes, one floppy at a time? Most certainly not. To give me a head start, let's add some serious networking power to this classic Performa 450. Let's talk about legacy network technology. I'm the Vintage Collector and these are my stories. In the early 1990s, most classic Apple Macintosh computers, like this Performa 450 you saw in the last episode, didn't come with built-in Ethernet. Instead, they relied on LocalTalk networking over serial ports, also known as LocalTalk, which topped out at just 230 kilobits per second. That's painfully slow by today's standards. You could use Apple's own proprietary cabling system or cheaper third-party options like PhoneNET, which let Macs network over standard telephone wires using RJ11 plugs. But as Ethernet emerged as the standard, running up to 40 times faster than LocalTalk, Mac users started looking for ways to get their older machines onto Ethernet-based networks. That's where Farallon Communications stepped in. Founded in 1986, Farallon quickly gained popularity for their PhoneNet adapters, which undercut Apple's pricing by using regular phone cables. As Ethernet adoption grew, Farallon introduced the EtherMac line, providing Ethernet connectivity for a wide range of Macs, from compact all-in-ones to pizza box LCs and even PowerBooks. Now, as I mentioned last time, the goal here is to get NetBSD running on this Performa 450. But juggling dozens of floppies is not exactly ideal. So today's mission is a key step, installing this Farallon EtherMac card and getting this Mac onto the network. No NetBSD just yet, but trust me, this part is essential. And while we're going full Ethernet today, I'd love to eventually dive into LocalTalk and PhoneNet and Macintosh file sharing just to show how these old Macs connected in ancient times. So if you happen to have any of that gear lying around for a donation or just want to help support these retro deep dives, feel free to reach out or become a channel member. If you, like me, are coming from the PC world, you may not have seen this expansion slot. This is the processor direct slot, which hooks up directly to the main CPU, directly exposing the CPU's data and address lines without going through a separate bus system like NewBus or PCI. Said that, it's not a general purpose slot like PCI on modern computers. So removing that bezel here allows me to plug in the EtherMac LC adapter card. I had to be a little bit careful though. Remember from our previous episode where I recapped this board? Using the radial caps instead of SMD ones, I had to watch out to not make any contact with the slightly larger capacitors. And luckily, they didn't. Anyway, I came prepared. Actual surface mount caps arrived just the day before, so I could swap them out if required. Once in place, the card gives us an RJ45 Ethernet port right on the back of the machine, ready for 10 megabits networking. Before we continue, a big thanks to PCBWay for sponsoring today's episode. They're celebrating their 11th anniversary and they've got discounts, vouchers and giveaways going on right now. Whether you're into custom PCBs, 3D printing or CNC, now's a great time to check them out on PCBWay.com. Now for the software. I do have the original Farallon driver disk, still factory sealed, so I decided to not touch it, just because. Thankfully, the EtherMac drivers are archived online and easy to install on the System 7.5. In my previous episode, I briefly covered installing System 7.5. It's no rocket science, just swapping floppies, but I was missing the actual install disk, so I had to fetch them from the Macintosh repository. Now, you can't mount or read those floppy images directly on a modern macOS system. But if they're raw 1.4 megabyte disk images, you can still write them using the dd command. No extra tools are needed. That's because Apple's high-density floppy drives use the same fixed rotational speed as PC drives. So 1.4 megabyte floppies are interchangeable between the two platforms. But don't try that with the old 800K disks. Those use variable speed drives, and neither modern Macs nor PC floppy drives can read or write them properly. Fortunately, the Farallon driver disk is a 1.4 megabyte high-density image, so I just wrote it from my modern Mac, popped it in, and ran the installer. It gave me both the Ethernet drivers and the diagnostics utility. After one reboot, I had it into the control panels and switched from LocalTalk to Ethernet, and just like that, Ethernet was enabled. One reason I went with System 7.5 was that it included MacTCP already from the start. This used to be an optional component for earlier versions, coming in for as high as $2,500 per site, before being lowered to just $60 and eventually being included for free with System 7.5. Heading over to the MacTCP control panel, I ran into a bit of a learning curve. It showed a generic class C IP address, and at first I didn't realize you're supposed to change that right here. Instead, I went digging through the advanced settings and got myself thoroughly confused.
You weren't really expecting modern networking to apply here, were you?
Somehow, I was. See, server mode isn't DHCP. It requires either a boot P or a reverse ARP server on your network. And dynamic doesn't do what you think either. It's neither DHCP nor the newer PIPA standard. No, you still have to define the network bits manually and let MacTCP pick a host address itself. Once I got that figured out, I tried pinging the Mac from a modern machine, but no response. Thing is, the classic system software doesn't come with a CLI or ping tool. You'll need to install one, like MacTCP ping, and, no surprise, that's only available as a MacBinary encoded file. Now, decoding BinHex on a classic Mac involves a bit of digital archaeology. I had to, first, download Stuffit Expander as a raw disk image, restore it via DD, and install it. Secondly, I transferred the HQX file on a FAT formatted floppy. Thirdly, I decoded it first to MacBinary, then extracted the self-extracting archive just to get the utility.
So it was a self-extracting archive inside the MacBinary encoded with BinHex.
Exactly. And if you're wondering, yes, placing MacBinary files directly on a DOS floppy does destroy them, even when done so from a Mac itself. Always encode them first to keep them intact. Anyway, once I ran MacTCP ping from the Mac itself, voila, ping replies started showing up on both ends. Turns out, the TCP IP stack on this classic Mac might not even initialize properly until you actually send something out from it. I didn't do a Wireshark capture at the time, but in hindsight, I really should have. My guess? Because I configured it for static addressing, and neither server nor dynamic, the Mac wasn't actively listening to ARP requests at all. Maybe it needed a reboot after switching from LocalTalk to Ethernet, or maybe the stack just stayed dormant until MacTCP ping kicked it into action. Either way, it worked, but I couldn't reproduce the behavior later. So yeah, one more mystery from the land of classic networking. At last, I added MacTCP ping to my recreated copy of the Farallon EtherMac drivers disk, so I'll have it ready for future installations. Next up, Fetch, the classic FTP client for Macintosh. As I had sorted my issues with transferring files, this was literally the last application I had to transfer over using FAT formatted floppy disks. With Fetch up, MacTCP running, and this Performa finally online, I was able to grab the final piece from my local FTP server, the NetBSD archive. And boy, getting into NetBSD turned out to be an entirely new rabbit hole. But that's the story for next time. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.